his films was the incredible virtuoso that he was with craft.
He was always on the cutting edge technically. And 2001's probably the best demonstration of his cutting edge knowledge.
It's become clear that this is one of the seminal American movies. It was a battle cry for a generation.
Everybody that I know now that has gone on to get awards and accolades were at that time just kids, just starting out. And 2001 was the picture that just ignited the spark.
2001. To see somebody actually do it, to make a visual film, was hugely inspirational to me. If he did it, I can do it. When 2001 first came out, I was in film school, which obviously it had a huge impact on me.
Anytime a Stanley Kubrick film came out, me and most of my friends were always the first in line to go see it.
You know, I remember very clearly the first day I saw 2001, it was opening day.
The theater was really cold. And so when we were in space in the whole second half of the movie, I felt like I was on board the spaceship.
I had no idea about the kind of trip I was going to go on. And I went on one of the greatest trips of my life.
Shivers went up and down my spine. I mean, now that is the kind of phrase that critics shouldn't use because it sounds so corny. But I want to say shivers went up and down my spine. They really did.
I was blown away by it, just like everybody else.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
I think it was the first time people really took science fiction seriously. Nobody had put the effort into special effects like Stanley had. Stanley really reinvented the medium.
When you look at it now and realize that he did it all on film, it's beyond me.
The special effects in 2001 were really the last flowering of photo-mechanical special effects.
It was such an advanced movie for its time. I mean, it's still amazing to realize that some of the shots involve so much engineering. I mean, you see the entire set rotating and the camera follows and the actors have to hit certain marks, otherwise they will fall down because the set rotates.
That was what Kubrick did. Anything that was presented to him as a challenge or something to do, he would immediately figure out how to flip it on its head, do exactly the opposite of what everybody had ever done before.
For the control room of the Discovery, they actually built a centrifuge. I mean, this thing was bigger than a house.
But what better way to simulate the revolving centrifuge of a spaceship than to build one full size and revolve it, you know, and let it turn 360 degrees? And it's masterful.
It's probably hard for anyone under the age of 20 to believe that we didn't have computers back in the 60s.
2001 was extreme quality control exerted by Stanley Kubrick himself.
I realized that I was following on everything I did, I was following something I really cared about, something I loved, something I was passionate about. And I kept following that passion. And eventually it led me to my huge passion, my real passion, which was making movies, which combined all of those things. And I realized that had I done what my father had wished me to do, which is to go into the office equipment business with him, my life would have been unpleasant. So I think it's very important not to do what your peers think you should do, not do what your parents think you should do, or your teachers, but to do what you inside, or even your culture thinks, but do what's inside you. I was dead broke, and so I had to get a job just to live. And so I had this deal to do this space film. And so I went to United Artists with this idea of the space film, and they turned it down. And then I went to Universal for the idea of the space film, and they turned it down.
On the eve of Star Wars release, 20th Century Fox, George Lucas, and the cast and crew brace themselves for the worst. One way or another, May 25th, 1977, would be a day they'd never forget.
We sent out a beautiful book, and that didn't seem to make an impact on them at all. We had very few bookings. Also, it wasn't that there had been Time or Newsweek or any of that stuff preceding this. It hadn't been screened and hadn't gotten the reviews.
Shot was one of the most important shots of the movie for the visual effects, because if the audience bought that shot, you had them.
The combined chest of everybody just kind of went, air was sucked out of the place. And then when the white stratosphere came overhead, I teared up. It was so powerful. I had seen that scene, but without music, without context, it's not the same thing.
We're doomed.
I never experienced special effects that were so real. I loved it because I loved the story and I loved the characters.
And there was a lot of hollering and cheering going on.
I said, man, that was, who worked on this?
I remember leaving the theater and having these kids ask us for our autograph. I said, no, you don't want our autograph. We're like model builders. No, no, we want you to sign this. So we were thinking, wow, this must mean something. People are asking for our autograph.
Everybody's standing up and applauding. Never seen this before in my life. I mean, and I'll never see it again. We released, I think, 37 theaters initially and broke 36 house records.
I was completely shocked. I think one of the key factors in the success is that it's a positive film. It has heroes and villains, and that it essentially is a fun movie to watch. It's been a long time since people have been able to go to the movies and see a sort of straightforward, wholesome, fun adventure.
Was unique and still probably remains to be one of the best of the best. If I hadn't got that, I wouldn't have had such a movie. I didn't look, there it was, and I went for it. I said, we haven't got digital effects today, and all those things that now help us to do anything. In those days, it was all by, you know, wires and pulleys. The art direction of the Nostromo and the Earth world would be, I decided, separate from the art director, who would be the art director for the alien. So Michael Seymour made all Earthworks. And H.R. Giger was in charge of the other side of the alien and actually got involved in drawing alien landscapes, etc.
Final report of the commercial starship Nostromo. Third officer reporting. The other members of the crew, Kane, Lambert, Parker, Brett, Ash, and Captain Dallas are dead. cargo and ship destroyed. I should reach the frontier in about 6 weeks. With a little luck, the network will pick me up. This is Ripley, last survivor of the Nostromo. Signing off.
I saw a very large canvas. I saw a very eclectic canvas where basically we were going to make our own rules.
Art direction, set design, I think generally was one massive challenge. That evolution told us it had to be this much money, we had to make it on a back lot.
Michael had a saying that when Ridley takes out the pencil, it's hundreds of dollars, and when he takes out a pen, it's thousands of dollars.
I'm going to be on the back lot. We've got to do the best we can. We have a limited budget. I can't make things like Stanley took at the time. I think 2001, for the time, was expensive. But he'd actually made everything, including the centrifuge wheel, and it all worked. And I would never have the budget to do that. That's why the idea of retrofitting things came about. It would have to be retroed to the surface of the back lot, which had traditional buildings, upon which we would put pipes and ducts and air conditioning. And one famous architect, years later, stopped me, brought me to his office, his rather superb office in London, and said to me, you know, we run Blade Runner about once a month, because he said, when I saw Blade Runner, the evolution of the beauty and technology suddenly became very apparent, which is where the building can wear the guts on the outside, and the guts become part of the decoration. And so that's the way we've gone with Blade Runner. So it was by necessity we actually kind of started to design it that way.
This is a rather different art department situation. Ridley's in charge of the art department on this picture, and I imagine on most pictures, but this one specifically. It's not quite fair to sound as though one's diminishing the art department or the art director or whatever, but one is, inevitably, in a way, because Ridley's so on top of it, and he's micromanaging the art department, which is probably hard for art directors to take, but okay, when the credit comes up, and it's them. Those guys had to work awfully hard to do what Ridley wanted, and they had to be very efficient to do what Ridley wanted. But it was Ridley who decided what it would be.
I love to work with illustrators and storyboard artists and really the best production designers I can lay my hands on, because that's where the fun is. And that's when you start firing off an idea and then they fire back, and suddenly the whole thing starts to generate this environment, which is fascinating.
Sid designed this whole world, but he designed not just what would be the map paintings, but conceived of what the streets would look like and what the neon would look like and what the lighting would look like and what it would look like when it was all drenched in grisly, oil-soaked rain, and then designed the vehicles as well. So the whole thing kind of knit together. Sid wasn't really the production designer per se, but he was the stylist.
I think it was a really smart decision to get someone who didn't have just an idea about the future, but he was actually someone who was an industrial designer and illustrator who was designing products for the future for people who were going to manufacture them.
I've seen things you people wouldn't believe. Attack ships on fire off the shoulder of Orion. I watched sea beams glitter in the dark near the Ten Hauser Gate. All those moments will be lost in time. Like tears.